Here we are in the Savannah River Lowground in Georgia with Dave Lekson, Chief of Regulatory in the Savannah District. And I thought that, Dave's an old friend from way back, and Dave's been in this wetland game for quite a few decades. And Dave is going to give us a little background on the natural history of these big swamps and marshes along the coastline, and sort of just give us a field trip verbally through them and explain some things. And I'll, as usual, I will ask the dumb questions.
I don't know about that. Well, thank you, Bob. It's great to see you. These areas are easily recognizable as a wetland and as a swamp, but in this particular location, it is right at the break point between the tidal interaction. This is kind of like the edge of a very large river bottom, as Bob said, the low ground. The bottomland hardwood, even wetter riverine swamp forest, some might call it. But in this particular location, we are very close to the break point between where these forests will sort of cycle out and you pick up the marshes because of the influx of salt water, the tidal action. And this area here also being tidally influenced, but fresh water. So there's an actual, you know, twice a day, coming up, going down, coming up. So there's very regular hydrology in this. We're way down the river basin. The Savannah River, as many people know, there are three major dams that are managed by the Corps of Engineers on the river that with mission for power generation, for flood control in particular. And so, but what that has done to these areas, it has flattened out the flood cycles, but also provides a more steady state where there's actually water moving, you know, here at all times. But anyway, we're down here toward right here in, you know, coastal Georgia. Beautiful areas, very recognizable. But 130 years ago, this would have been rice plantation.
Is that right? Okay, we're back. We had a momentary visit by two park rangers. I guess Dave and I looked a little suspicious and seedy, but we're going to pick right back up. And you were mentioning as we stopped, Dave, that this is a regrowth, regeneration forest, 100 to 150 years. And I wanted to ask, has this come back in what you would consider would be very close to natural conditions? Not too many invasives or disruption to the community.
It's a beautiful example of a what you would think is a, you know, classic southern swamp with the buttress, the butt swell, the tupelo gums, the cypresses. You've got red maples, and then you get into the oaks, the wetter oaks along the fringe. So yes, very, you know, looking right now, we do have a lot of invasives in this area. Certainly, you've got the river coming in, the tidal action, you know, delivers seeds, etc. But this is I don't see, you know, any indication of, you know, noxious species invasion or anything. Mm-hmm. So you're looking at, you know, as good as it gets.
All right, yeah. All right. So you were saying earlier that this is maybe 7 miles from the coast. This is a wetland from this point, 7 miles from the open water. Right. And as you get closer to the water, more salt influence, and there you get the more grassy marsh type.
That's correct. You get more salt tolerant species as the trees reach their tolerance level, and it transitions out to more herbaceous and what people would recognize as a marsh. And our common marsh species here, Spartinas, Spartina alterniflora, the cordgrass, etc., and the juncuses, sedges that people are familiar with. Right?
Okay. So these obviously provide, there's an interesting flora here. Maybe I ought to ask, because this sort of intrigues me. So the genesis of a site like this probably goes back through the eons and has something to do with rise and fall of the oceans, riverine systems must influence the surface geomorphology and the soil types.
Yes, totally. You know, you look at the post-glacial period that we're in, and certainly with climate change, we are definitely seeing changes in our wetlands up and down the East Coast, for sure, areas I'm familiar with, but certainly around the world is areas that, you know, may have been growing pines are now growing cypresses, and areas of growing cypresses have now transitioned into marsh. I mean, we're seeing that now. But these large river basins, you know, and our marshes have been carbon dated, 25,000-30,000 years old. This being an alluvial floodplain with the flooding and the deposition of silt and clays, etc., very fertile. That's why they were farmed. That's why we had rice, etc. And so, that continues somewhat modified by the impacts on the free flow of the river. But these wetlands here represent a very, very important water quality function. As Savannah and in the surrounding coastal areas, the Floridian aquifer has been depressed through, you know, groundwater draw for water supply, and, you know, transitioning back into surface water, drinking water for humans. And these areas, these wetland areas, they're filtering, they're uptaking nutrients and toxins, etc., and helping to treat that water before it gets to the intakes for the people of Savannah and the surrounding area to drink. And so as clean as that water can be delivered to the systems, that's actually saving us money. Yeah, and as we protect these areas, when we get to draw the water off and then have to treat it before we drink it.
So in a year's time, annually, how, because you can see we have water marks, but they're not very high on the buttressing of these trees. How much of a rise or fall of water is in here? And is it coastal influence, riverine, or both?
Right. Yeah, here, again, we're at the bottom. Right. And so it's a little bit of both. But primarily, if you can imagine, there's a flood tide coming down. If we're having astronomical high tides from the ocean, then you can get a jump here, you know, 3 or 4 feet.
Oh, wow.
Through this area.
Wow.
So again, what these areas provide is a place for that water to go before it hits town.
Yeah.
So if we were to clear all this and fill it and build something on it, you're losing that square footage of storage space
right.
to assimilate those floodwaters. So again, we talked about water quality functions. Now we're looking at, you know, flood flow attenuation and storage of those floodwaters. So, not to mention, we've been listening to the birds and the like, not to mention the wildlife habitat functions and values of these areas.
So being more of a Western botanist, and I could talk all day about alpine or grassland floras, I'm curious, as I was standing here and you were mentioning some of those things, across the width of this, how diverse for vegetation? You know, we have, I could see several aquatics and some other wetland plants sticking up. But is there like a real diverse parts? The sum of all this, is
the
there a lot of different species in here?
There are, and of course, as you get out, your crown closure, your trees will limit sunlight reaching the ground, which in turn will limit somewhat the lushness or the thickness of the undergrowth. As the trees open up, as you get out towards the marshes, then there will be a burst of more herbaceous species composition. But the floodplains are fascinating in that they're not static areas. Of course, we try to keep the river in its channel, but over the millennia, that river has meandered. It's continuing to want to do that. So if you look at an aerial photo, you'll see old sloughs, or bayous as they might call in Louisiana, the backwaters of where the old river was, and you'll find entire different plant communities within there. And then you go up onto the old levees, and then you get another different suite of species back down maybe into a lower area. We're standing water all the time, so you could find
flats. There's pine trees, and you might not realize that you're in a floodplain area. Mm-hmm. And these would have been the areas that were farmed, for sure. Mm-hmm. An area like this might have been too wet for farming, been used for timber production, etc., as it is to this day.
Yeah. Now, we're in a part of the country where we have the highest biodiversity, obviously the highest diversity of hardwood trees and shrubs, and also the herbaceous vascular plants. Are there many sort of species, regional endemics, restricted to these kinds of habitats? Or are there more widespread wherever this habitat occurs?
Right. What we're seeing here is, I would say, would be indicative of the coastal plain of the Atlantic seaboard, southeast and Gulf Coast, common along the big, large rivers, with the cypresses, the gums, tupelo gum, water tupelo, black gum, very common, red maple, sweet gum, willows, depending on where you are in the landscape. So it would be, yes, it's common of the southeastern United States, right, parts of Florida, but as you get down deep into Florida, then you get more subtropical and even tropical towards the very bottom.
Right.
So,
the bird life is?
Bird life?
Given all the bird calls you were doing.
Well, I tell you, this time of year, we have a pulse of the neotropical migrants that come through here in the springtime, headed north. I'm just going to catch one here. That's a wood boring beetle right there. But anyway, we do have the coastal species, shorebirds, waterfowl. We have a lot of refuges in the area, so that attracts a lot of waterfowl. We have wood storks, endangered species. A lot of people will see the wood storks flying around, and they're like, man, these can't be endangered. They're everywhere. But it's like, well, actually not. What you're seeing is 75% of what's left. You know, you get a big flight, so that's it. This is where they are.
Yeah.
So these areas are very valuable. We were talking water quality, flood flow attenuation and storage, and then the biggie, the wildlife habitat.
Okay. So I guess these are, you know, to summarize or to start to pull this back together, the development of the terrain is coastal and low floodplain near the outlet, sets it up. Are these all sands below here?
Primarily, because we're coastal.
Okay.
Sands, but you'll have, you know, build up of silts and clays from flooding over time. But,
okay.
Generally parent material, you know, sands to a certain point, then you get more marine sediments because over the millennia, sea level rise, fall, and we're in another rising cycle now.
Yeah, okay. And so the soils are rich in organics associated with these types of habitats. And then I guess I'm a little bit fascinated with the human use of these over the last couple hundred years with influx of European settlers and whatnot.
Of course, we weren't the first ones here.
And how did they utilize these?
So, this would be home, this would be food, this would be shelter, this would be, you know, bows and arrows and everything. You know, half of what I'm looking at here is edible, produces mast, produces, you know, acorns, etc., fruits, berries. A lot of it you can saponic. You can wash with it.
Yeah.
You've got species make cordage.
Did they do any burning here?
Burning was part of a strategy. A lot of the reading I'm doing, especially up through North Carolina, they would burn and then hunt as the burn would move through. There was also burning associated with, as they became less hunter-gatherer and more sedentary, associated with clearing and managing their farm fields. And so the large canebrakes that we find in the southeast Many of them are actually the ancient fields that they grew up in cane, and that's the primary species, or the remnants of the old Native American fields.
And then the influx of settlers or European
influence.
Right. And then we begin logging.
Logging.
And draining and or development of rice fields.
Rice. There's mining. Mining the old levees, sand mining. And so they're removing the sand. And when you get, again, look at the aerial photos, and you'll see these ponds around the intersections where
the
roads
are.
They're digging the sand and they're building roads. They're filling to build building pads because this is the low country.
Yeah.
And so sand, you know, fill material is of a premium.
And did they do a lot of logging, like for shipbuilding?
There was the naval stores. Certainly in Georgia had a big naval stores community right behind. Over there is an old longleaf pine that may have been used to collect pitch for creating tar and turpentine, part of the naval stores industry. But when the advent of paper, and certainly with the hardwood, the white paper, is a big industry in Georgia for paper products. It's one of the biggest in Georgia's, number one for chickens, peanuts, pecans. And then our forest products are really big.
So in other locations, these are managed and logged on some cycle.
I know, bro. So you look here, you look at it, and a lot of people will look at this and say, oh, this is a pristine old growth. Well, yeah, it is old growth, and yes, it is pristine, but this is probably maybe second or third generation of what was here. These trees 100, 125 years old.
Right.
They'll live, the cypresses will live thousands of years, if it's not logged again, which it may or may not be, then it will go through its cycles. There'll be trees falling and there'll be opening. You talked about diversity earlier.
Right.
A storm comes through, blows a bunch down, and then there's a pulse of activity, plant growth in that area. It's all part of the natural successionary processes that happen in these areas.
Now, for the second part of this, we thought we'd just show you a few plants that Dave typically was showing me that he finds in these kinds of wetland systems. We're obviously out in the wetland edge, and we're going to do just a little walk up into the uplands, and Dave will point out some of the common species he sees as we go along.
Right, and again, you asked me about these particular ecosystems, and there are some common understory species that we find once the crown closes, but here's one that's great. It's a great time of year for this. This is lizard's tail and cernuus, and you can actually see the lizard's tail, but it's a great one because later on in the year, if we're in a drought situation, the water may recede and there may not be no water anywhere, but these plants will still be growing.
Now this particular species, the lizard's tail, this goes all the way up into New England. And it's not even in a coastal environment. It'll be inland too, as well as this next one here.
Right, and that's, this time of year, the blue flag iris is beautiful, beautiful blue flower. Very common, they'll grow in dense beds. You'll see them. There's a mature one over there with the seed pod, the capsule. But these are very common species that we find.
And I've had different old naturalists, we'll call them, or botanists, in the past explain to me that a lot of reason you find these, especially the wetland species, are so common, there's a lot of relationship, is that birds are moving all the seed sources. So they may winter here, but they bring the seed source to us in the summer.
That's good point.
But as we probably go upland, we don't have anything much of what I'm seeing over here.
Oh no, this will very water tolerant, but it will be outcompeted by other species as we go up the hill.
Okay, all right. And what is these, we're surrounded by these gorgeous fans.
Love the palmetto, which when you think of the deep south, you think of the live oaks with the Spanish moss and the palmettos.
And you were telling
one time,
me
yeah, a source,
they make baskets?
That source of fibers, cordage, roofing materials. So there was, so you had the shelter part of it. They're all of these are fruiting, and so at a certain point, there'll be edible fruits that will come from that. So that's the food part.
Really?
And you can make hats and other articles of clothing. So you got food, clothing, and shelter from one plant.
Have you eaten any of the fruits?
I have.
What do they taste like?
They're bitter.
Oh, really?
Depending. There's certain species that, of course, there's things that have been introduced.
Right.
That are sweeter, very much like a persimmon once it's mellowed.
Mm-hmm.
But some of them are wonderful, more sweet.
Okay.
As you can imagine, a plant trying to survive in an environment that's just underwater all of the time, you can see some of the adaptations of these trees. They're swelling at the butts and or buttressing where it supports the tree. And we noticed out here the a classic people will know when they see a cypress knees or a pneumatophore, function of gaseous exchange, and that provides the tree with oxygen in such an oxygen poor situation.
So we moved up. We're still on the wetland. We're in the wetland edge in
still
transition.
Mm-hmm.
And Dave has pointed out a couple ferns here to us, and I thought we would like to know what they are and maybe anything about them.
And here's a classic one that's valuable to us in the context of identifying wetlands. It's a netted chain fern, but it produces its fruiting body comes up, and it's a black stalk, and it's persistent. So even in the winter when this is gone, the black stalks are still there, and you can still identify where the beds of these will grow in big beds. But it's a very well adapted for wetland conditions and a very common species that we
now
find.
Now up our way, we have something that looks like that, but I know this isn't it, but it's the sensitive fern looks like that.
And very often confused with the sensitive fern that has a different leaf pattern.
Yeah.
Some will say you can look underneath and see a netting underneath the leaves, but.
And this is the cinnamon fern, which again, another common wetland species.
Now I'm going to jump in and reinforce something I've been teaching in some of our videos and classes. This is a twice cut fern. Come up the frond, go out this pinnae once, and then these are all cut to the midrib twice.
Twice.
So it's a twice cut fern.
Okay. So what you're working on in terms of identification, you couple that, we're talking about the pubescent stem, the hairiness of the stem.
Yep.
You're just adding to the accuracy of the identification.
And it's also another dimorphic fern, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
And it too has a separate fertile stalk frond.
Right, comes up, and that's where the cinnamon part of the name comes from. This large stalk that comes up, that you shake it when it's ripe, it just throws spores everywhere. Sometimes misidentified for the Virginia chain fern, because the Virginia chain fern has
but
black
it's got
rachis.
The blacks. Yes. Yeah, it's got the black.
But kind of same leaf form.
Okay, we're at our next spot here.
Okay.
You want to show me something else?
Yeah, the palmettos. We were looking down there, and they are in flower now, actually. And here's a great example. It will grow this long stalk. It's flowering these little white flowers. And of course, each one of those will produce a fruit, and that's edible. This one actually has two stalks coming off. But I had pushed this out of the way as I was coming through. This is, again, another very common wetland plant that we see from the swamps all the way up into the wet flatwoods areas. And this is a rundinaria, or this particular species most likely a rundinaria tecta. But it's a
switchcane. These are
cane.
The canes?
These are the canes. It's actually a grass.
Yeah.
But it's got a, tough exterior, so some might argue, is it a woody species? Is it a herb?
Well, this is a tribe, a group of grasses in the bamboo tribe.
In the bamboo.
And of course, Dave and I appreciate bamboo because of bamboo fly rods.
Absolutely.
But this is the North American version of the bamboos.
Right. And of course, the Native Americans use this to great effect in basketry, bows, arrows, and other implements. But when I, again, another very common wetland plant in this area. But looking down, again, we have more of the netted chain fern. But then looking underneath, here's an interesting find here, actually several, a couple, with the partridge pea and then the wild ginger. And so this is one that you can crush. In fact, the old timers, when they're making soap, they would add this to the soap as the scent in the soap. And I'm sure some of that still occurs today.
Good. Well, I go.
Oh, you got an answer.